Hello, welcome in the context of the first lecture of the Process Mining Summer School. In this recording, I will explain the first chapter in the handbook of process mining. In this first chapter, we introduce the basics of process mining. We talk a bit about the representations that we are using, the input for process mining, event data, and we will talk a bit about all the different process mining tasks that exist. And this is to prepare you for more advanced topics. My name is Wil van der Aalst. I'm a professor at RWTH Aachen University, and I'm also the chief scientist at Celonis. So let's get started. So the goal of this course is to provide a complete overview of everything that has to do with process mining. And in this first lecture, I will try to give you like a 360 degree view on the different elements of process mining. And you will see that the topic is actually very broad, but we start very much with the basics. So let's first take a look at the development of the field. So if you look at the development of the field, it is clear that process mining was the first approach that was really trying to combine data science with process science. I think everybody has a pretty good idea what data science means. So anything related to dealing with data, ranging from machine learning, using neural networks, to things like statistics, database technologies, traditional forms of data mining, etc. On the other side, we have the field of process science that is very much focused on improving processes. And before process mining, people were typically modeling processes. They were implementing processes, doing simulations. But typically, the data generated by these processes was not really used in the field of process science. However, with the availability of data, it is super clear that if you want to improve processes, you need to use the data. Therefore, process mining is combining these two areas. So this is a small timeline of the field of process mining. So you can see that it started in the late 90s. In the mid 90s, I started to work on workflow management technology. But after a few years, I felt a bit disappointed because I saw many organizations purchasing workflow management technology, then tried to introduce it, but many of these projects failed simply because real-life processes were much more complicated than the simplistic models that were put into these workflow management systems. So that is why at the end of the 90s, I started a new research project where I first coined the term process mining. And my goal was to no longer model processes upfront, but to try to extract the real processes from the actual data generated by these processes. This led to innovations such as the first discovery techniques. I think most of you have heard about the ELF algorithm or the heuristic mining algorithm. Then we developed the first prototypes. And after a few years, we started the development of PROM. And gradually the field matured until the field of process mining as we know it today. If we break this up in a bit of periods, then one could say, okay, in the first couple of years, the focus was very much on control flow discovery. We were just looking at the ordering of activities and trying to model that in terms of, for example, a PetriNet or a directly follows graph or predecessors of BPMN models as we know them today. After that, we started to add other perspectives, like for example, time and data. So this was the time that there were the first, let's say, performance analysis techniques developed in the context of process mining. This is when we started to work on conformance checking, decision mining, etc., etc. So at the end of this period, we were already able to generate simulation models that were trying to capture completely the process as we have been observing them today. So if people today talk about digital twins, they often refer to this idea. You observe processes and you automatically generate models that mimic the behavior that we see in reality and that can be used to make decisions. This was still very much an academic exercise. And after this, the field started to expand. So we created the IEEE Task Force on Process Mining. We created books, courses, etc., etc. So for example, my first process mining book came out in 2011. The later book was published in 2016. But also, for example, in 2011, the company Celonis was founded. And what we see in recent years is that the field has matured, as is reflected by this summer school, where it is clear that there is a huge interest, both in academia and industry, in this topic. There is also the ICPM conference that is attracting many people. There are much more books available, much more applications, etc. If you look at the tooling side, then in the beginning the focus was on tools like PROM. So we moved from creating one tool for every method to making an integrated tool called PROM that would embed many different process mining algorithms. What we have seen after that is that many of these ideas were picked up and were put into commercial tools. And the number of tools has been gradually growing over the last, let's say, 10 years. If you look at the adoption in industry, that was lagging behind a bit. So first there was the research, then there were the tools which lowered the threshold to start using process mining. What we see in recent years is that there is a great adoption of process mining applications in industry. I will come back to that later. So that was a short timeline that we get a sense of the history of the field. If you now take a high-level view of what process mining is all about, it starts with the extraction of data from information systems. So in information systems, data may be scattered over thousands of tables, and we would like to extract events from these different tables. This is often much more difficult than one expects. Then once one has extracted this data in the form of event data, one can start exploring it. And what you often see is that there are data quality problems, or there are strange, unexpected things that you find in the data that make you go back to the original information system and start the data extraction again. If you have a pretty good idea what is in the event data and you feel confident with that, you can start doing process discovery. So since the alpha algorithm, there have been like a continuous stream of new discovery techniques to automatically discover process models, trying to describe the event data as they have been observed. One can show these models to people, and often these models are surprisingly different from what people expect. If you have such models, you can also interact with these. So you can say, okay, this is the model that describes the as-is situation, but I would now like to transform it into a model that describes a to-be situation related to the events that we have seen in the event data. So models can be aimed at describing the current situation, or models can be aimed at describing the desired or the to-be situation. Independent of the focus, you can always replay event data on top of these models, and you can use that to show where the model deviates from reality, or where reality deviates from the model, and you can use it to show where the bottlenecks are. And so, using this, you can automatically see where are performance and conformance problems. And of course, this is extremely valuable and immediately gives lots of insights that help you to improve these processes. If you have processes and they are relatively stable and you are able to create models from them that make sense, then you can go to more advanced techniques. Yeah, so if you have enough data and your process is relatively stable, you can use these models to predict what is going to happen next. So you can predict, for example, for a running case, how long will it take until this case is completed. One can also use it to see, okay, will there be a bottleneck in this part of the production process tomorrow. This is also where machine learning comes in. So machine learning does not play a role during process discovery and aligning the event data with these models. However, after this, you can generate machine learning problems using the process mining lens. Process mining is a great generator of machine learning problems where you cannot directly apply machine learning on the data that is in your information systems, but using process mining you can transform it in such a way that you can use it. So you can use it to make predictions about bottlenecks, deviations, and all kinds of other problems that you may encounter. Using all of this information, either by humans looking at performance and conformance diagnostics, or using automated machine learning models that predict that something is going to happen that you don't want to see, you can start improving your processes. So one of the things that you can do is that if you detect that there is a problem or there will be a problem tomorrow, you can automatically trigger actions. Or people can use the insights to improve the processes that are being supported. So this is a top-down view, which immediately shows why this is a very relevant topic for most organizations. However, we need to make it more concrete, and we also provide the bottom-up view. Let's start with some process mining basics. So the starting point for process mining is event data, and every event corresponds to something that has happened. One can think of it as the execution of an activity, or the recording of some measurement, or something like that. So in this table, every row corresponds to an event. And for every event, we can have a bunch of attributes. In this table, I just showed the top part, there are over 71,000 rows. If you look at each row, it is referring to an order, indicated by the first column. The second column is describing an activity. The third column is the person, the resource executing that. We have a timestamp, we have the product, a price, a quantity, address, etc. And so these are just examples, but the minimum behavior, that the minimum information you need to be able to do process mining is that for every event you have a case identifier, an activity, and a timestamp. And so this is the minimum information that you need to get started. What you typically see is that timestamp is very easy to recognize. Activity, I think, is also clear. If you have a table and you know what it represents, you are able to distill the activities. What is in some cases, in some applications, super clear, in other applications very difficult, is what is the case notion. Here in this super simple example, the case identifier is referring to an order number. If you look at event data for example, hospitals, your case identifier could be a patient. If you are doing learning analytics, your case ID may refer to a student taking a particular course. So this case notion can mean many different things, and I will come back to that later. So if we assume that we just have a case ID, an activity, and a timestamp for every event, we can basically sequentialize every case. So if we look at the first case here highlighted in blue, and we look at the events that have happened for this case, and we just look at the ordering of the corresponding activities, then we find so-called traces. And so the blue trace is describing the sequence of activities for a case called order 6350. We can do the same for the red case highlighted here, order 6351. Which just has three events. So we simply sort the activities based on the timestamps that we have. The same for the green order, and it is very similar to the blue one, only we see that two activities are being swapped. So here we see how we can convert the data that I was showing on the previous slide into sequences of activities that we call traces. If we have such traces, we can simply count how often the same trace or the same process variant occurs. So if we look at the blue one, then we see that there are actually over 8,000 orders that follow exactly this pattern of placing an order, sending an invoice, making a payment, etc. If we look at the cancellation scenario, we can see that it happens 1,651 times. We see the green scenario that happens almost 3,000 times. And there are two traces that are very infrequent. And together, they only happen 37 times. And this is interesting because we can clearly distinguish between the mainstream behavior, which is indicated by the first three variants or traces, and we can see this exceptional behavior, which is characterized by the fact that people pay before they get an invoice. Yeah, so these are people that are eager to pay. So given such representation of our original event data, we can put this into, let's say, process mining software. And we can automatically discover models, we can see bottlenecks, we can see deviations. And what is very important to realize is you can do all of this without modeling. So you just push a button and you automatically get process models that describe what is happening in reality. So you can use this to diagnose performance and compliance problems. The first added value is that based on process discovery, you can show what is going on in your process. You can even animate reality on top of these models, and you will exactly see, you can trace a particular order through the process. You can see where the bottlenecks are. Every event has a timestamp, and you can simply look at the delays between different events, and you can use that to indicate where the biggest bottlenecks are. And here in this visualization, the more deep red activities are, the longer the waiting time is in front of these activities. You can also use it to diagnose compliance problems. This is typically called conformance checking. So now you start with a model that is not completely capturing your data, but you can start, for example, with a model that captures the frequent behavior. What we have seen before, there were some behaviors that were very frequent, and there were these 37 cases that were infrequent. If we discover a model based on the mainstream behavior, we get a model that is highlighted in blue, and the red arcs are showing where reality is deviating from this mainstream behavior. So here we see the 37 cases where people were paying before they got an invoice. I can select these 37 cases and I can drill down and I can look which cases are having this deviating behavior. So this is the scenario that we would like to find outlier behavior. What is highlighted here in blue could also have been the normative model, the model that we want or that we expect to be followed. If that is the case, you can see, let's say, compliance problems. And so the difference between what really happens and what you would like to happen. So the models that I've shown so far are super simple, just a few activities. What is for most processes easy to show is, let's say, what we call the happy path or the highways in the process model. So this is a larger data set, and here I'm showing a so-called directly follows graph in PROM, which shows what are the main paths through the process model. What we can do is we can lower the threshold, and if we do that, then we also see, let's say, less frequent paths that are being taken. And if we look at everything, we see something like this. And so we often call these diagrams spaghetti diagrams. And if you look carefully, you can see that there are many connections that happen only once. And so this is when we try to visualize all the directly followed relationships. And this immediately shows that what people typically show on PowerPoint and what is reality is very different. So this very simple approach can already be used to see lots of problems. So it's not uncommon that if you do this, even for simple processes like purchase to pay and order to cash, that you will find thousands and sometimes hundreds of thousands of different variants. And this gives a lot of information about possible inefficiencies. So you see problems caused by handoff, rework, duplication, ineffective communication, etc. So to summarize, we are able to discover what is really going on, and we can use this to show where are the biggest compliance and performance problems. And based on this, you can generate suggestions to improve the process, or in advanced scenarios, you can even automatically improve the process. If you have enough data and your process is in a stable situation. So this shows a bit why this is super relevant. If you now look at it more scientifically, what are now the different process mining tasks for which you need to develop algorithms and which are embedded in these commercial process mining systems? That is, first, process discovery techniques. Second, these are conformance checking techniques that try to compare reality as it is reflected in the event logs and reality as it is described in process models. You would like to see the differences. You can use it using replay. You can see how much time is being spent in every state or activity of the process. The fourth task is comparative process mining. So you can look, for example, at the same process in two different months. So you look at the process in January and you compare it with the process in February, and you can diagnose the differences between this. Another scenario would be that you have two factories basically producing exactly the same product and you would like to compare them. You can also think of this as, the, for example, that you are looking at the treatment of patients in different hospitals and you would like to compare that. Or you would like to compare the treatment of patients having a different gender. Right? So you can basically compare any two groups of processes or even cases within the same process. Then there is the field of predictive process mining, where we are using process mining to generate machine learning problems. And of course, we do not stop at generating predictions and diagnostics. Of course, the ultimate goal is to actually change processes. And the field of action-oriented process mining looks at how can diagnostics be turned into actions to actually improve processes. So this is all a bit overwhelming, and let's start with the basics. So initially, in this first course, we just focus on control flow, and we start focusing very much on the first two activities, process discovery and conformance checking. Later, so also if you look at the book, then you can find much more information about advanced topics. But you first need to understand the basics. And the basics starts with describing what are process models and what are event logs. So please bear with me. Before I can talk about process discovery, I need to talk about the input being event data and the output being process models annotated with information about bottlenecks, deviations, etc. So I'm going to use a running example. So often when you take an unstructured process and you discover a process model for it, it looks like spaghetti. That's why we often talk about spaghetti models. If it's more structured, we talk about lasagna models. And to introduce, let's say, process models and the corresponding process mining concepts, I start with the BPMN model that describes the preparation of a pizza. So in this BPMN notation, we have a start event and we have an end event, and we execute a sequence of activities. So here the process starts with buying ingredients, then creating a pizza base, and after creating a pizza base, we execute three activities: add cheese, add tomato and salami, but they can be executed in any order. And so this is a so-called AND split, this is a so-called AND join, and that is indicating that there is no predefined ordering between these three activities, but they all three need to happen. After adding the three toppings, we bake the pizza in the oven, we eat it, and we clean the kitchen, and then we are done. So if you look at the notations here, then we have a start event, an end event, activities. We have an AND split, also called gateway in BPMN. So we have an AND split and an AND join. In this model, there are no choices. So we do not have any exclusive choice gateways. So now my question to you would be, okay, how many scenarios can be executed here? How many possible traces are there, even though there are no choices? Well, it is clear that if we look at this middle part, that this can be executed in different ways. So we first pick the first activity. So we have three possibilities for that. Then we pick the second activity. So we still have two possibilities remaining. And if we pick the last activity, only one possibility is remaining. So we have 3 times 2 times 1 possible ways of executing the middle part. And the beginning and the end is always the same. So there are 6 possible executions. If I represent the same model in terms of a PetriNet using short names, so for example, BI refers to buy ingredients, etc. So if we are using short names and we try to represent it in terms of a PetriNet, it looks very similar. But now the notation is different. Here are the elements that we have. So we have places corresponding to the circles. We have transitions corresponding to the squares. Places and transitions are connected through arcs. And there are so-called tokens. So what this is representing is that it's exactly the same process. So in the beginning, we execute by ingredients, then create pizza base. Then we can add the three toppings in any order. And this is modeled using concurrency. And in PetriNet, that looks like this. Only after we have done all of these three activities in the middle, we can create, we can execute a bake in oven, eat pizza, and we can clean the kitchen. So here you see the modeling elements, and the way that the PetriNet works is that a transition is enabled if each of its input places contains a token. So for example, bake in oven is only enabled if there is a token in this place, and in this place. So a transition needs to have a token on each of its input places to be enabled. If it is enabled, it can occur, often called firing. And if a transition fires, it consumes a token from all the input places and produces a token on all the output places. So transition BO consumes 3 tokens and produces 1 token. If we look at transition CB, it consumes 1 token and it produces 3 tokens. So if we execute BI, we move the token from here to here. If then we execute CB, we consume 1 token and we produce 3 tokens. And when there is a token in the input place of AC, a token in the input place of AT, and a token in the input place of AS, these 3 transitions are enabled concurrently. They can happen in any order. You can think of them that they could even happen at the same time. Yeah, but we are assuming that these activities are atomic, so we can just talk about the sequential ordering of these atomic activities. And if we do that, we see that there are indeed, again, the 6 possibilities. So we first fire one of them, then 2 are remaining, then we fire the second one. Finally, for the last one, we do not have a choice anymore. And only then there is a token on each of the 3 input places of BO. And BO can fire, putting a token in the place here. So just to visualize this, what I just mentioned, but I explained you already quite exhaustively what the rules of the game are. If we are in this state, which is called the marking in PetriNet terms, BI is the only transition enabled. So What I'm going to do is that I'm showing in green the transition that is enabled, so the activity that can occur. All the ones that are shown in let's say white color, they are not enabled yet. So the only thing that can happen is that BI occurs. As mentioned before, in PetriNet terms, we often call this firing. Then after the occurrence of BI, there is a token on the input place of CB. So this is now the only transition that is enabled. We will fire it and we produce three tokens. In this situation, there are three transitions that are enabled. And in principle, any one of them can occur first. Let's assume that AT fires first. Then we are in this state. So AT is no longer enabled, but also BO is not enabled yet because two of its input places are empty. So the only thing that can happen is that we can add cheese or add salami. Let's assume that we first add salami, then BO is still not enabled because it needs to have a token on each of its input places. So the only thing, the only transition that remains enabled is AC. If we execute AC, then finally there are three tokens on the input places of BO. So every of the input places contains a token, and that is enough to enable it. Then BO is the only one that can occur. After this, we can eat the pizza and we can clean the kitchen and we reach the final state. So in such PetriNets, we often have something like an initial state and a final state. And the goal is to look at all executions going from the initial state to the final state. This is called an accepting PetriNet. So on the slides, I'm sometimes referring to the formal definitions of the Process Mining Handbook, Chapter 1. And in this, in such an accepting PetriNet, we have an initial marking and a final marking. And both are corresponding to a multi-set of places. And so we often consider the situation where a place contains at most one token for every case, but in principle, the notation also allows for places that have multiple tokens. Of course, if you are considering multiple pizza preparations at the same time, there are multiple tokens in this process model, but they are all flowing through it in an independent way. So an accepting PetriNet has an initial state and a final state, and we are interested in the behaviors that leads from beginning to end. And here you can see, let's say, two possible executions where I'm focusing on the middle part. So what is indicated in red, if there is no choice, it is always exactly the same. But in the middle part, we have the adding of the three topics, and that can happen, toppings that can happen in any way. And so we have 3 × 2 × 1 = 6 possible traces. Let's now go to yet another process representation. So we have seen BPMN, we have seen PetriNet, very close to each other. And here the same behavior is expressed in terms of a process tree. Why are we introducing all of these representations? Different process mining techniques use different representations. And these are the ones that are most commonly used. It's very important that you understand all of them, but you also see that the conversions of going from one notation to another notation is fairly straightforward. So process trees have many advantages when discovering them. So for example, one of the very important advantages is that you cannot create models that have live locks or deadlocks or other anomalies. And so if you have a process tree, by design, the model is free of deadlocks and other problems. If you look at the tree-like structure, there are four possible operators. The arrow corresponds to sequential composition. The cross corresponds to exclusive choice. We have the end symbol for parallel competition, and we have the looping symbol for the so-called redo loop. In this example, we only see the sequence operator, and we see the parallel composition operator, also highlighted in the model. And the behavior is exactly the same as before. So we start with buying ingredients, then we create a pizza base, then concurrently, we have added the adding of the topics in any order. Then we bake the pizza, we eat the pizza, and we clean the kitchen. You can also represent this tree in a more compact representation that you see here. And so we have a sequence of six different elements, where one of the elements is again a subtree that starts with an end node connecting through to the tree activities corresponding to adding the topics. So it's very easy to map the semantics of a process tree onto a PetriNet, and that is highlighted here. And so given the explanations that I just got, I think it's pretty straightforward that such a tree, if we look at this behavior, it is also described by this PetriNet. The last notation that we look at are the so-called directly follows graph. So directly follows graphs are often, if you use a commercial process mining tool and you load the data and you look at the first visualization, what you typically see is the directly follows graph. And so from a practical point of view, this is very relevant. What you see again is that all the activities are represented as nodes. We have a special node for the start of the process. We have a special node for the end of the process. And every arc is describing that it is possible that this activity is followed by the next activity. What you see is, for example, that buy ingredients is always preceded by the start node. And from the start node, this is the only activity that we can execute in the beginning. After buying ingredients, the only thing that we can do is creating the pizza base. After creating the pizza base, there are three possible subsequent activities, and that is indicated by these arrows. Unlike a PetriNet, it's not that we take all branches at the same time. No, we just take one branch. So every node, you can think of it as corresponding to the last executed activity. So if we are here, then the last activity that was executed is AC, and subsequent activities are BO, AT, and AS. And so from this activity, we can reach this activity, and this activity. So you can think of the activities as a kind of state corresponding to the last executed activity. So here, of course, the behavior is different than from a PetriNet. Just to visualize this, we always start in the start node. And again, we are considering traces going from beginning to end. So in the beginning, the only thing that can happen is that BI is executed. Then we are in this state, where we just executed BI. The only thing that can happen here is that CB is executed. Then we are in this state. And from this state, there are three reachable states indicated here in green. And so there are three possible next activities. If we start by picking AT, then we end up in the state where AT was the last activity. After this, we again have multiple possibilities. So we can go to AC, we can go to AS, we can go to BO. Let's assume that we go to AS. After this, there are again three possibilities. Let's assume that we go to AC. Then we bake the pizza, we eat the pizza, and we clean the kitchen, just as before. So this is one possible execution. And I deliberately picked an execution that was also possible in the PetriNet, the BPMN model, and the process tree. That all had exactly the same behavior. So this was one complete execution, but there are many of them. So for example, here you see two example traces, but there are many more possibilities. There are actually an infinite number of possibilities. And so for example, we can go from buy ingredients, create pizza base, and then we can just add one topping and immediately go to the end. And that was not possible before. And so you can create a pizza with one topping, but you can also create a pizza with 100 toppings, because you can go through these loops as many times as you want. So there are infinitely many possible executions, showing that the BPMN model is able to describe the original traces, but also describes much more. To make our example a bit more realistic, we are going to add three additions, three complications. The first difference that we add is that there is a choice between salami and mushrooms. That was not possible before. We also add the possibility that pizza can be added multiple times, and you can skip eating the pizza. So if we look at the BPMN model, it looks like this. And now we have more gateways. Before we only had an AND gateway, but now to model the fact that we can skip eating the pizza, that there is a choice between salami and mushrooms, and that we can go through this loop, for that we need to have these exclusive choice gateways. All the other operators are exactly the same as before. So after buying the ingredients, creating the pizza base, we start three parallel branches, and what we can do, just like before, we can add cheese, add tomato. What we now can also do is we can add mushrooms. And so this is a new possibility. So there is a choice. If we take this parallel branch, we can either do add salami or we can do add mushrooms. After that, we reach a so-called XOR join. And here we have an end join. So one of these toppings needs to be added, this topping needs to be added, and this topping needs to be added. There's also the possibility to loop back, and this is modeling a skip. And so we have an XOR split, so we either go immediately to the next activity, or we execute eat pizza. So this is highlighting the extensions that I mentioned earlier. So we have a choice between salami and mushrooms. Cheese can be added multiple times, but at least once. So we always go through add cheese, but after that we have the choice to go back in the process and to do it again. And we can repeat this as many times as we want. And as I've explained, we can now skip eating the pizza. So if you now look at the number of traces, because there are these loops, of course there can be infinitely many. So what I just showed you was the BPMN model. I can simply map this onto a Petri net, and then it looks like this. So now we are using silent transitions to model the skipping of the eating of the pizza, and we model it for the choice after adding the cheese to do it again. And so this silent activity allows us, if there is a token here after AC, we can either go to bake oven when the other tokens are also there, or we can go back and repeat this as many times as we want. Also here you can see the new transition compared to the PetriNet before, where we can add mushrooms as an alternative to adding salami. The process tree looks like this. This will probably be unsurprising, but you can see that we are now also using the so-called redo loop and the exclusive choice, let's say, node or operator. So first, this is the easy part. So in sequence, after baking the pizza and cleaning the kitchen, there is an optional activity EP, and this choice represents that we can either eat the pizza or skip it, indicating by a tau. So tau refers to a so-called silent activity, something that doesn't correspond to a real activity. Then we have the AND part. Before we already had the fact that we have these three parallel branches. Add tomato is always executed. What we also have is that there is a choice between add salami and add mushrooms. That's new. And we have a so-called redo loop. And the redo loop has two children. The leftmost child, we always execute that branch. And after executing that branch, we can immediately stop, or we execute the right child of this redo loop operator. And if we execute the right child, after that we will always execute a new one. And so that is why this is called a redo loop. So in this example, we always execute AC. After AC, we either stop or we execute the silent activity, which corresponds to doing nothing. But after executing the silent activity, we go back to executing AC, etc. So this construct allows us to model the fact that AC, add cheese, is executed at least once. If I swap these two, that tau is on this side and AC is on this side, that would correspond to executing AC zero or more times. Now it models the fact that we execute AC one or more times. Note that instead of AC, this could be an entire subtree. Yeah, so it is a hierarchical approach. Any of the leaves here can be again replaced by a complete subprocess. So if you look at the semantics, it's again very easy to express this in terms of Petri nets. So for example, if you look at the yellow part, the choice is modeled as we have seen before. If you look at this choice, the choice between salami and mushrooms, that is indicated like this, very easy to understand. And the redo loop is also very simple, so we always execute AC, and then we have the option to go back using this tau transition or not. So the semantics can easily be mapped from process trees onto Petri nets. If you look at the corresponding DFG, and again, I'm just looking at, okay, which activities can be followed by which other activities, then we see a few differences. So first of all, we see a new activity, add mushrooms. We also see that we can have a self loop on add cheese, because we can have add cheese followed by itself. We also see the possibility to skip eat pizza. So this is very corresponding to the extensions that we have seen before. So of course now the interesting question is again, just like before, so this is the PetriNet representation that is exactly the same in terms of semantics as the process tree and the PPMN model that I showed before. And we can compare this with the DFG. And what the DFG shows is that there is much more behavior possible. And so for example, here add tomato is always executed once. Here in principle it could be skipped, that you never add tomato, or you could add tomato multiple times. And so if we look at the traces generated by the PetriNet model and by the directly follows graph, then the number of possible traces is much larger if we look on the right-hand side of the DFG model. So the DFG model allows for not adding cheese. Yeah, so we can have the sequence BI, CB, AT, BO, CK. We can also not add any tomato. We can also, what you can also see is that in one run, we can also add salami and add mushrooms, so it's no longer an exclusive choice. How to see that? You see that there are loops here, so we can go through these loops as many times as we want. So we can add as many toppings as we want. So to summarize, we have seen the typical process model representations used for process mining. We have seen the BPMN notation. This is the industry standard. We are focusing here on a small subset, but this is the subset that is most often used. It is also most relevant in the context of process mining. Yeah, so we only have AND and XOR gateways. Then we have PetriNet. This is the oldest and on the scientific side, most widely used model for modeling concurrent processes. This is often underneath many of the approaches that you see. So it's easy to transform a BPMN model into a PetriNet. Then there are process trees. We have also seen that process trees can be mapped onto PetriNets. They can also be mapped on BPMN. And there is this more primitive process modeling notation called DFGs, where basically every node corresponds to both an activity and a state, being the last activity that was executed. So that was on the process modeling side. Now we go to event data. In the beginning, I already illustrated that a bit. So if we look at, let's say, normal event logs, one can think of them as, let's say, such a CSV file as I showed before. And so for every event, we have a bunch of attributes, and there are special attributes like time, activity, and case identifier. Based on this, we can group all the events corresponding to a particular case, and using the timestamps, we can create an order. Yeah, so this is the, let's say, the life cycle of pizza 56, and this is the sequence of activities executed for that pizza, the red one and the green one. So if we, in these trace representations, we basically dropped resources and customers, we can also no longer see the exact timestamp, we only see the ordering. So we can think of this as a simplified representation of what you see in this table. So events, event data like this, we refer to that as a normal event log. Event data represented as just traces, we call that a simplified event log. And note that many cases can correspond to exactly the same sequence of activities. That leads to the following formal definition. I will run through this quickly, but again, please take your time to study the book and to really understand what this means. I think it's crucial that you're very familiar with these basic concepts in order, even if you are using process mining in a more applied sense, that you really understand what you're doing and how to interpret the resulting models. So the formal definition starts with defining a bunch of events, the universe of events. We have a universe of activity names, and so these are sets that correspond to possible activity names, a universe of cases, a universe of timestamps, and so we have a set of events, a set of activities, a set of cases, and a set of timestamps. Then we have attributes and attribute values, and we have mappings that are partial functions mapping attribute names onto values. And so this is a very compact notation to show that, okay, we can have mappings from attribute to values. Intuitively, you can already see that corresponds basically to the row of a table, where for some columns you have a particular value. We assume that these are disjoint, just for convenience, and we are assuming that that we can talk about an event's activity, its case, and the timestamp. These mappings have a special meaning if we have activities, cases, or timestamps. Then we have an event log. An event log is a collection of events and a mapping, mapping any event onto a map. And so every event is mapped onto a function that is mapping attributes onto values. And we have an ordering of events. And so we assume here it's a strict partial ordering. You can also think of it as a total ordering if the rows in your table already have a particular order. So for any event E, an attribute that is in the domain of this mapping for event E, then the attribute of that event can be denoted in this way. And so this is the value of attribute AT for event E. And so here you can see examples of expressions. So this is the activity corresponding to E, the case corresponding to E, and the timestamp corresponding to E. If you're not familiar with this, it is not so super important, but you can see you can mathematically describe the concepts that I've explained before. If events have a timestamp, we assume that the ordering of events is consistent with the timestamps. So if an event has a smaller timestamp, an event E1 has a smaller timestamp than event E2, then it cannot be that E2 has happened before E1 according to this partial ordering relationship. So what I just showed was, let's say, the normal event log. Think of this as the formalization of an Excel table. To simplify it, we can reduce such notations by only looking at sequences of activities. And as mentioned, the same sequence, which we call the trace, can happen multiple times. And so the blue trace that we see here may occur many times in a given event log. That's why formally a log is a multi-set of a sequence of activities. Again, if you're not familiar with this mathematical notation, it's not a drama, but you have to realize that an event log, what it actually is in mathematical terms, can be described by just a few symbols. So we talked about, let's say, a regular event log. Think of it as a CSV file with three special comments, columns, case, activity, and timestamp. Then there is the so-called XCS standard. This is an official IEEE standard that has been around since 2016, but the development actually, we started that already in 2010 with the first proposals. There was also a standard called MXML, which was the predecessor of XCS. Several tools support the standard, and compared to the, let's say, simplified event logs that we talked about before, is that it extends, for example, event data with the possibility of having case attributes. Before, we only had event attributes. We can, so XCS extends the basic model with lifecycle information if you want. So you can indicate that an event is a start event or a complete event. And then we have so-called activity instances that, for example, are formed by a pair of start this activity instance until it is completed. Yeah, so two events are basically linked together, where one represents the start and the other represents the completion of an activity. There are also special notations for resources, roles, groups, costs, etc., etc. And so this is a more extensive representation. One step further are so-called object-centric event data. And this is now a hot topic in the field of process mining. And the expectation is that also many of the commercial vendors in the coming years will completely adopt this notion. Yeah, so Celonis was the first to, let's say, fully embrace this with the so-called process sphere. And the basic idea behind this notion of object-centric event data is that we drop the case identifier, so no longer events need to have a single case. But an event can refer to any number of objects, and there can be different types of objects. So for example, if you here look at activity by ingredients, again, it has an activity name, a timestamp, but then it is referring to different objects. And so the location is a supermarket. Think of supermarket as an object. It refers to three customers. It is also referring to three pizzas. And we are using a super simplified example, but you could also imagine that if you are creating the pizza and you have different topics, that you could have different objects representing the different topics. If you think like a lecture in a summer school, you can also think of the lecture taking place as an event, and that event would refer to one room, one lecturer. It is done in the context of one summer school. There are, for example, 130 participants. There are 150 chairs in the room. People are tweeting during the lecture, so the event lecture is also connected to tweets, etc., etc. So one event may refer to any number of objects. Of course, this is a bit of a strange example of pizzas and lectures. But you have to realize that in real life, most of the events that we are trying to analyze are actually not referring to a single case, but are referring to multiple objects of different types. If you have this situation, you can always flatten this into a normal event log. This is also defined in definition 5 of the book, chapter 1. And the basic idea of flattening is that if you take pizza as a case identifier, for example, you replicate the first activity three times so that you have one execution of the activity for every pizza. And so if we we take pizza as a case identifier, the first event would be split into three events. If you take resource as a case identifier, there's only one event. But again, if you take customer as a case identifier, this first event will be split into three events, one for every customer. So as I said on the previous slide, these examples were a bit artificial, but if you think about the placing of an order, it may be one order that is created referring to five items for one customer, and later for this order that there may be a payment, again referring to the order and the items and the customer. We can think about delivering a package. One package may contain four items of two different orders for one customer, etc., etc. Yeah, so if we look at the check-in activity, one passenger is involved, the passenger checks in two suitcases, it is for a particular flight, and an employee is doing this. So object centricity is actually the normal situation, and squeezing this into this case notion is in many applications very limiting. So what often happens if you take real data, for example, data from a system like SAP, having thousands of different tables, and if you look at a particular process, you do not need to look at all of these thousand tables, but let's say that you're looking at 20 different tables, then you need to spend a lot of effort converting this data into an event log for a particular question. So what you often see is that if you start extracting it, you do it from a single viewpoint. So that's why we often say that if you do process mining in the classical sense, so not object-centric, you always need to translate the 3D reality into a 2D image. And if you do object-centric process mining, you don't have to do that, because the data is stored in such a way as it actually happened, and you can create your own viewpoint on the fly. So if you're interested in this topic, this is a hot topic in research. Many of the PhDs in our group in Aachen are working on this. And what we also see is that in industry, there will be increasing adoption, starting with ProcessSphere of Celonis. So if you look at event data, again, we have four different flavors of different complexity. So we have the simple event log, which we mathematically describe as a multi-set of a sequence of activities, or a multi-set of traces. That is the most simple form. Then we have a normal event log. Think of this as a CSV file, where every event can have multiple attributes. Some of which are freely chosen, but the three mandatory ones that you need to have are case ID, activity name, and timestamp. Then there is the more extensive version of normal event logs, standardized in the IEEE standard XCS, which is an official IEEE standard, where there are several extensions. So for example, you can store cost information, or resource information, or transactional information in the standardized way. And then there is the most, let's say, sophisticated state-of-the-art type of event data, which is called object-centric event logs, where every event can refer to any number of objects, and we identify different types of objects, like, for example, resources, items, orders, payments, etc., etc. So what we have now seen so far was process models, event data, and let us now look a bit at the available software. So the available software is able to turn event data into process models, but it doesn't stop there. It's also possible to identify execution gaps, for example, bottlenecks or frequent deviations. And you can drill down on these problems, apply machine learning, and you can see what the root cause of these different, let's say, execution gaps may be. So at this point in time, there are over 40 different tools. If you go to our webpage, www.processmining.org, you will find a wealth of information. So here you will find information about software, about event data, courses, papers, etc., etc. So I highly recommend, if you are interested in process mining, this should be bookmarked in your browser, because it very quickly gives you lots of insights. My personal way of illustrating, let's say, the spectrum of process mining tools is to talk about PROM and Celonis. And I will also show some screenshots. So PROM is the de facto standard tool in the academic community for people developing open source process mining algorithms in a common platform. It is very much driven by academics. It's running locally on your machine. It is not, let's say, industry strength, in the sense that it's focused on the single expert user. There is no way of running it in the cloud and making it available to thousands of users at the same time. On the other side, there is, for example, a commercial system like Celonis. This is not open source, it's closed source, it's commercial, it is cloud-based, and so it's not running on your laptop. The advantage is that it is much more scalable, and it also allows you to that many users are looking actually at the same data and benefit from the process mining diagnostics. It's also possible to create dashboards, so it's also very accessible to non-experts. And so this is the spectrum. If you want to get to use PROM, you can download it freely from this webpage. If you look at the development over time, the first release had only 29 plugins. The latest releases have, let's say, over 1,500 plugins. The goal of this infrastructure is to share capabilities. So it's very easy to chain different process mining algorithms together. And there are different flavors of PROM. So there's PROM that has these 1,500 plugins if you want. There is PROM Lite, which is typically used in educational situations, which is using a subset of these plugins that are most easy to use. There are also nightly builds that incorporate the latest innovations. And PROM has also been integrated into, let's say, scientific workflow tools, like, for example, RapidMiner. And there it is called RapidProm. It is open source, and here you can see information about the licenses. So just to get a flavor of it, but I highly recommend you to play with this yourself, is you can load data in the form of a CSV file or an XES file, or also many other let's say formats are supported, for example, also OCEL, so this object-centric event log format. You can load it, and what you then see is, for example, a visualization of the different traces and how frequent they are. So, for example, this is information about the treatment of patients, and you can see that there are 285 patients that follow the pattern that you see here. In this entire data set, there are over 11,000 events. There are almost 1,900 traces. And if you look at the number of variants, it is almost 200. You can also plot it looking more at the timestamps. So what you see here is every dot corresponds to an event. Here you can see the color coding of the different events. And so, for example, the green activity is the initial examination. What you see here is on the x-axis you see time, on the y-axis you see the different cases, and this is one possible visualization. But if you look at this panel, you can see that you can basically customize this visualization in any way you want. Then there are dozens of process discovery techniques. Given the data that I was describing here, you push a button and you can automatically create a PetriNet describing the data. And again, you can see that we are able to discover loops, concurrency, choices, etc., etc. On top of these models, you can, of course, animate the different cases, and this helps you to drill down and to understand For example, if there are unexpected behaviors, when they happen, and you can try to generate explanations for it. Because data is time-stamped, it's almost trivial to also show bottleneck information, so where is most of the time being spent. You also see frequency information here. If you pick a normative model or you mine a model just focusing on the most frequent behavior, you can also see the deviations. So here, the dashed red lines correspond to deviations. You can click on any of these deviations and you can immediately see the cases that have this deviating behavior. So just what is shown here is conformance checking seen from the model perspective. You can also take the log perspective, and what is highlighted now in blue are the activities that are executed according to plan. If you look at the red ones, they correspond to deviations. So these are activities that either have happened but could not happen, or activities that should have happened but did not happen. Of course, there are also simpler representations like, for example, directly follows graphs. That's what you see here, using, for example, a very nice plugin which is called the Interactive Data Aware Heuristic Miner, which also allows for directly follows graphs. It also allows for CNETs. So this is the formalism underneath the heuristic miner, which was one of the first miner, probably the first miner, also able to deal with real-life data. And here you can see bindings corresponding to the ends and the ors of your process. So what I just showed is just the tip of the iceberg. So these were just five of over 1,500 plugins. Very important, you need to experience this yourself. And you will see that once you get into it, it's relatively simple. As promised, we looked at PROM as a primary example of an open source academic tool. I also show you a few screenshots of Celonis. So Celonis is by far the most successful commercial process mining tool. I joined Celonis also as chief scientist. Celonis was founded in 2011 by Alex Basti and Martin. And the characteristics of Celonis are bringing process mining closer to the real end users, making it scalable that you are able to deal with billions of events. Very important is it has a so-called process query language, PQL, which allows you to quickly drill down into, for example, particular problems. And you can also, based on the diagnostics gathered using process mining, you can automatically take actions. Celonis bought a company first called Integromat, it's called Make Today, that allows you to do low code workflow automation. And so just to show a few screenshots, so here you see the screen that you can use to load data. So you can connect to an entire database, you can upload an XCS file or a CSV file. Then the first view is typically that people look at the directly follows graph, and that I explained earlier, that you also saw in PROM. In these directly follows graphs, you can either look at frequencies or you can look at times. And so now you can see the arcs that are thicker are the arcs where most of the time is being spent. You can do the animation, so every token is now corresponding to a particular a case. You can look at process variants. So here I look at the most frequent variant. And of all the cases, 285 cases follow exactly this pattern. And we can add other variants, and then this process model becomes more complicated. You can also write PQL statements. So this is this querying language. And you can generate, for example, tabular information that you can use as input for machine learning techniques. And so here you see, for example, the expression that you need to write to look at if this was the last activity, what is the average time until the end? But this is flexible. You can basically ask any question. You can upload BPMN models. You can also generate BPMN models using the inductive mining technique. So Celonis is using process trees to discover the underlying process model. And then these process trees are visualized in the form of BPMN models, as you can see, for example, here. And so this is based on the data that I showed earlier, also in the context of PROM, this is the BPMN model that is discovered using the inductive mining technique. You can save this model, you can also modify it by hand, and then do conformance checking. So here you can, for example, see if I simply take this discovered model, then every case is conforming, we do not see any problems. If we just take the most frequent scenario, the happy path, this corresponds to 50% of the cases. If we then say, okay, let's do conformance checking, you can see that the percentage of conformance cases is indeed just 15%. Here you can see how it fluctuates over time, and you can drill down on all the different deviations that you see. And so here you see a list of the most frequent deviations, and you can drill down on all of them. And so you can see what are the cases that have this deviation and what do they have in common. Important in, let's say, real life applications is that diagnostics can be turned into actions. So what you can do is that if you see a certain problem using process mining, you can connect it to these action flows, and these action flows then simply start executing activities in the existing systems. And so these action flows support over 1,000 different commercial systems, where, for example, SAP is one of them, Salesforce is another of them, etc., etc. So if you want to use Celonis, it is of course a commercial tool, but you can go to the academic sign-up to get a free version. There are also, let's say, versions of Celonis that are limited, for example, in the size of data sets that they can handle, that you can use to play for free. So that was the software. Now let's briefly look at the applications. So applications are basically everywhere. So here you see some examples of companies using process mining grouped in different industries. So of course the finance and insurance industry was one of the first to adopt process mining, but it's definitely not limited to administrative processes. You can also look at production, logistics. It is applied in healthcare settings, telecom operators. Most of the larger energy companies are using it, food and retail, consultancy, etc., etc. And so all the big consultancy firms have very large, let's say, expertise centers helping customers to get started with process mining. If you look at Celonis, Celonis has thousands of customers, and here you can see some of the logos distributed over, let's say, some of the industries that I mentioned earlier. And then you can see that indeed most of the larger companies are already using process mining, and we are just at the beginning. Of course, it's vital to realize that process mining has connections to many different fields. Here I just spoke, okay, we have event data and we try to get a process model. But for example, the data extraction part is typically something very complicated and far from trivial. And so you need to load and extract the data, possibly from a variety of systems having sometimes thousands of tables. You load that, but after doing the process mining, you also want it to have an impact on reality. And so we earlier looked at that, for example, action flows to automatically trigger actions again in the systems where you were extracting the data from. So this is automated, but of course, process mining is also related to change management. If you see that there are certain recurring problems, you want perhaps to change your organization. And so it is a very broad topic, having connections with, let's say, very technical topics like automation, but also very much with organizational issues, such as change management. Also issues like privacy, etc., play, of course, an important role when applying process mining. So let us now conclude by looking at a number of trends. So a first trend that you can clearly see if you are observing the process mining space is the shift from the focus on generating insights to actually taking actions. And so for a very long time, the transformation of insights into actions was something that was done very much manual. And we can see that with action flows, this is much more integrated. Another trend that you can clearly see is that process mining pays off if you are able to scale. If it is a small project, it will typically not work. I can explain this better by using the example of making a weather forecast. If you approach process mining like a project, it's a bit like, okay, let's try to make a weather prediction for the weather in Aachen next Sunday. If you do something like that, you could create a project, you could start gathering the data, forming a team, etc., etc., and then you can try to make a prediction of the weather. This is probably going to be very difficult, right? Because you are doing many things for the first time and it doesn't pay off because you're doing it just once. It will probably be very problematic because you don't have experience. But after doing that and the project stops, the value is gone. If you use this example, then you can see that continuous company-wide process mining is corresponding to the scenario where you do not just want to make a weather forecast for Aachen, but you want to make it for example, a weather forecast for all European cities, and you do not want to make it for next Sunday. No, you would like to do this every day. And then the return on investment is much better than if you approach it like a project. But this requires management that is willing to commit to this and seeing that is the only way forward to really improve processes. If they keep this small-scale proof of concept projects, it is impossible to show the true value of process mining, which is much better when you are able to scale. So summary and outlook. So the summary is that process mining is a very broad topic. It starts with process discovery. Then there are topics like conformance checking, performance analysis that are pretty basic, where lots of techniques are available. There are also more, let's say, sophisticated or advanced topics like making predictions by combining process mining with AI and machine learning, or comparative process mining to exactly diagnose what the differences are between two processes or the same process in different periods, to actually automatically generating actions to immediately improve processes. If you look at this picture and you relate it to the things that I've been talking about, I explained in a lot of detail the core representations important for process mining, and these are process models such as BPMN, PetriNets, directly follows graphs, and process trees. These are the key representations that are used inside process mining tools and inside process mining algorithms. We also spoke about the input. So we have the simplified event logs, which are just a multi-set of traces, to more, let's say, sophisticated forms where we can have any number of attributes, until the so-called object-centric event logs, where we do not restrict ourselves to a fixed case notion, and we are able to let's say resolve lots of challenges that classical process mining approaches have. So in the next lecture, I will explain how to go from this event data to these four types of process models. So we start with, let's say, the first and probably most intriguing topic, how to discover process models based on event data. Here are some pointers to get more information. I explained the processmining.org website, where you can find information about data sets, about tools, about lecture material, etc., etc. But there are many other websites available, and here you can see a small selection of them. There is also a website dedicated to this summer school. So next to these websites, there are these online courses. I give two examples here. So there is the Coursera course that is based on let's say, the process mining book, and that already attracted over 150,000 students taking this course. There is also the much more recent course on process mining from theory to execution, which is more compact and more linked to the Celonis process mining software. If you look at the books, then there is the standard process mining book. And there is, of course, also the book of this summer school, where in this lecture I basically explained chapter 1, and in the next lecture I will explain chapter 2, which is dealing with process discovery. Have a lot of fun with this material. Thank you.